The Hassan reduced the original number of degrees of initiation from 9 to the mystical number of 7. A similar number of regulations formed the rules of the order. This, in fact, comprised the working plan of the spreading of the faith. The first rule was that the missionary must know human psychology in such a way as to be able to select suitable people for admission to the cult, and was summed up in the mnemonic, quote, cast no seed upon rocks, unquote. The second rule of procedure was the application of flattery and gaining the confidence of the prospective member. Third came the casting of doubt into the mind by superior knowledge. Fourthly, the teacher must apply an oath to the student never to betray any of the truths which were to be revealed to him. Now he was told as the fifth stage that Ishmaelism was a powerful secret organization supported by some of the most important figures of the time. After this, the aspirant was questioned and studied to discover whether he had absorbed the opinions of the teacher and attached himself sufficiently into a position of dependence upon his ideas. And at this stage, he was asked to meditate upon the meaning of the reported saying of the prophet that, quote, paradise lies in the shadow of swords, unquote. In the final degree, many difficult passages of the Quran were explained in terms of allegory. How is it that the rules of this extraordinarily successful order are known in such detail? Well, it so happened that when the Mongols eventually overthrew Alamut by force of arms, their chief, Halaku, meaning destruction, Khan, asked his chief minister to examine their library. This most learned man, father of kings, Jawani, later wrote a careful book in which he detailed the organization of the assassins, whose name he attributed to the use of the drug hashish, which they were said to use in stupefying candidates for the ephemeral visit to paradise. It is possible that recruits were made in another way than by selecting gullible, fully grown youths. Legend has it that Hassan, once master of Alamut, used to buy unwanted children from their parents and train them in implicit obedience and with the sole desire to die in his service. Buzurg Umid, meaning great promise, the second grand master, Grand Master is still used today, folks, maintained the power of the assassins on much the same pattern. Building new forts, gaining fresh converts, terrorizing those whom he did not want to have killed, and using them to further his design of world conquest. Sultan Sanjar of Persia, in spite of several expeditions against the viper's nest, as Alamut was now being called, could do little about him. Viper's nest was the term given by the assassin's enemies. The assassins themselves called it the eagle's nest. Ambassadors on each side were slain. A notable religious leader was captured by the assassins, given a mock trial, and flung into a furnace. The Grand Master at this time seldom put on the field more than 2,000 men at a time. But it must be remembered that they were killers, acting under an iron discipline, and more than a match for any organized army that they might ever have to face. Now the order began to spread in Syria, where the continued contact with the Crusaders was established. The Warriors of the Cross were in fairly effective control of an area extending from the Egyptian border to Armenia in the north. Bahram, a Persian leader of the assassin cult from Astrabad, gained control of a mighty fortress in Syria in the region known as the Valley of Demons, Wadi al-Jan, and from there spread out from one fort to another. The Grand Prior Bahram now moved to an even more substantial fortified place, Masyat. Bahram's successor, Ismail, the lash-bearer, planted a trained devotee on the saintly vizier of Baghdad, into whose confidence he worked his way to such an extent that this assassin, now called the Father of Trust, was actually made Grand Judge of Baghdad. The Crusaders had by now been about 30 years in the Holy Land, and the Assassins decided that they could usefully form an alliance with them aimed against Baghdad. A secret treaty was therefore made between the Grand Master and Baldwin II, King of Jerusalem, whereby the Ismaili Grand Judge would have opened the gates of Baghdad treacherously to the Crusaders if the fortified city of Tyre were handed over to the Assassins for their part in the transaction. Well, as with most plans, something went wrong. The judge had ordered an underling to open the city gates. This service had told the military commander of Damascus, who lost no time in killing the man, the vizier, and 6,000 people believed to be secret assassins within the city. The Damascus garrison fell upon the Crusaders and beat them back in a thunderstorm, which the Christian warriors attributed to divine anger at their unworthy pact, and the Assassins as an attempt by the powers of nature to allow the Crusaders into the city under its cover. Meanwhile, the Grand Master was indulging in an orgy of destruction of individual rulers who opposed his creed. The list is interminable, but this is a fair example. Quote, the celebrated Aksumkur, Prince of Mosul, was a warrior equally dreaded by the Christians and the Assassins. As this prince, on his return from Ma'ara Mazrin, where the Muslim and Christian host had parted without venturing to engage, entered the mosque at Mosul to perform his devotions, he was attacked at the moment when he was about to take his usual seat by not one, but 8 assassins, disguised as dervishes. 3 of them fell below the blows of the valiant emir. But ere his people could come to his aid, he had received his death wound and expired. Unquote. The fanaticism which inspired the killers was shared, it seemed, by other members of their families, who had been thoroughly trained in the bloody creed. For the historian Kamal Eldin relates, on this occasion, when the mother of one of the youths who attempted Aksumkur's life heard that he had been slain, she painted her face and donned the gayest raiment and ornaments, rejoicing that her son had been found worthy to die the glorious death of a martyr in the cause of the Imam. But when she saw him return alive and unscathed, she cut off her hair and blackened her countenance and would not be comforted. Things thus continued for the 14 years and a quarter of the second Grand Master's rule when he died to nominate his son, Kia Muhammad, as his successor. Under Muhammad, the killings continued. A part of the seacoast of Palestine came into assassin hands, and the cult leaders reaffirmed their overly belief in Orthodox Islam. In public, Ismailis were ordinary Muslims. The secret doctrine of the divinely guided leader was not to be discussed with the uninitiated. Don't miss tomorrow night's show. Good night, and God bless each and every one of you.